not this. It may be
is it there? Good morning, everyone. Good morning, good morning. All right. All right, whenever you're finished talking, I'll start. Good morning. Welcome to the house of the Lord. We're here today to worship God, and as the scriptures say, this is the day. This is the day that the Lord has made. Let us rejoice and be glad in it. Welcome to worship here at Cuba United Methodist Church. We're doing some new things today, and the choir is back, and it's just an exciting time to worship the Lord. And we're going to begin with announcements, and Ken's got those for us this morning.
Thank you. Good morning. A few announcements to share with you. If you've been enjoying the treats after worship on Sundays, please add your name to the sign-up sheet if you can. Apparently, numerous dates are still available to do that. A reminder that Laundry Day at the Cuba Laundromat is next Sunday, September 17th, from noon to 3 p.m. We provide money and supplies for others to do their laundry. Just bring yourselves. Everything else is provided through the funds from our noisy coin collections. And the kids are welcome to join in that effort also. And we have royalty in the house today. Bailey Elliott was crowned the 2023 Harvest Festival Queen this past Thursday night.
Hail to the Queen.
All right.
She also won the interview and talent and was sponsored by People's Bank. Congratulations, Bailey. I see she's wearing her crown here this morning.
Requirement.
As the acolytes bring the light of Christ into the sanctuary, would you please be in an attitude of meditation?
And then I'm going to call us all to worship. If you look up on the screen. No, it is, and it is after. Okay, like I said, new things, and we've already got microphones that don't work and everything else, but we believe that the Lord and the Holy Spirit is going to make all of it work. So, as he said, let's be in an attitude of prayer.
Thank you.
All right, our call to worship is on the screen. Come out of the darkness of despair and into the brightness of God's transforming love.
We praise God for God's presence with us.
Prepare your hearts and spirits to receive God's mercy and healing.
We thank God for God's mercy toward us.
Come, let us praise and worship God who is always with us.
Would you please rise for our opening hymn, The Mighty is Our God.
So part of our job as the opening hymns is we try to pick songs that both praise God and worship God. And we kind of try to separate them where we always pick like an upbeat, positive one. And it was recently brought to our attention that we're getting kind of repetitive. So this one is a newer one where we extol how mighty is our God. And then the second hymn is almost always a more worshipful hymn, where or more prayerful hymn, if you will. So here are our two selections. The first one is pretty easy. I know this is our first time doing it, but as soon as you catch on, join us.
Let's be in prayer. Gracious God, we come this day seeking courage and hope for the future. We gather this morning in a time and place where our world is in such peril. And we need healing, and we need quiet. And we need to quiet the words of anger and calls for war among us that we're hearing. Help us to be those who bring peace in our families and communities. Banish the darkness, O Lord. You are the God of light. Banish the darkness of doubt and fear. Anoint us with your light and love that we may spread the good news of your mercy to everyone. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Please be seated. It's great to have the choir back this morning. We're looking forward to them singing, and we're going to have church. Children's time now, if you'd like to come forward for the children's program. Thank you.
Okay. All right, so we're going to start by doing a little bit of an activity. So I'm going to tell you guys what to draw, and you need to draw it just the best you can, okay? It doesn't have to be perfect. I'm not an artist, so I'm not expecting it to be perfect, okay? So I am thinking of a place, okay, place from somewhere. Go ahead and draw it. Yep, I'm thinking of a place. Go ahead and draw it. Okay, here, I'll give you some hints. Okay, this place is a building, and it has a door. Now go ahead and draw it. Okay, you guys are close to what I'm thinking, but not exactly. So this place has a door and a couple of windows. Okay, again, you guys are close. How about I give you guys all the details and then you guys can draw it? Does that sound okay? Okay, so this place is a building, and in the middle of your building is gonna be some doors, and on either side of the doors is gonna be two windows. There's gonna be one window on one side, one window on the other. And then on the top, there's going to be a steeple, and on the top of the steeple is a cross. And then there's going to be some steps coming out of the front and a couple of trees out front. The steeple is like the triangular piece that comes off the roof. And then on top of the triangle is a cross. What do you think? What is it? It's a church, right? It's a church. So that's what I wanted you to draw, okay? Now, why was that hard to do at the beginning? Why didn't you guys know exactly what to draw at the beginning? Yeah, so I didn't give you all the details, right? So I had to teach you and tell you all of those details, okay? Part of Pastor Todd's teaching that he's going to do today is reading from Romans 13, and it talks about listening to your authorities. Now, authorities can be a lot of different people. It can be your teachers. It can be Pastor Todd. It could be the mayor in your town. It could be policemen, okay? Sometimes it can even be a babysitter that's coming to watch you, right? Okay? So in Romans 13, it says, God gives us a bunch of commandments, so he gives us a bunch of laws. So God is our ultimate authority that we listen to. And he gives us a bunch of laws, and then he says, whatever other command there may be are summed up in one command. Love your neighbor as yourself. So all of the other pieces that we listen to and all the people that we listen to, it comes back to listening to God and showing his love in everything that we do. So when we listen to other people, we show God's love. And then we create a community where we can gather all together and show God's love to everybody, right? How are the churches looking? Are they looking good? Okay. All right. Go ahead and put your pens down, sorry. And we'll pray real quick. Okay. Dear God, I want to thank you for bringing us here today. I want to thank you for giving us a chance to dig into your word this morning. I pray that this week as we go into the world that we will continue to listen to you and other authorities so that we can show everyone the love that you have given us. Thank you for loving us every day and for showing us the way. In your name we pray. Amen.
Good morning. Good morning. Good morning. It's on. Okay, good. Yay. You know, everything would have been just fine this morning had the microphones worked, but we didn't know they weren't going to work. So anyway, we're going to push forward, and part of our new order is we're going to go ahead and get into the scripture and the message today, and then we will have our time of prayer after worship, after our time of opening the word and listening and sermonizing, if you will. Romans 13, 8 to 14. Don't be in debt to anyone except for the obligation to love each other. Whoever loves another person has fulfilled the law. The commandments: don't commit adultery, don't murder, don't steal, don't desire what others have, and any other commandments are summed up in one word: you must love your neighbor as yourself. Love doesn't do anything wrong to a neighbor. Therefore, love is what fulfills the law. As you do all this, you know what time it is. The hour has already come for us to wake up from our sleep. Now our salvation is nearer than when we first had faith. The night is almost over. The day is near. So let's get rid of the actions that belong to the darkness and put on the weapons of light. Let's behave appropriately as people who live in the day, not in partying and getting drunk, not in sleeping around and obscene behavior, not in fighting and obsession. Instead, dress yourself with the Lord Jesus Christ and don't plan to indulge your selfish desires. This is the word of the Lord for us, the people of God. Thanks be to God for his word to us today. Love one another sums up the law. Okay? Is that the message that we hear from Christians on social media? Is that the message we hear from other people, whether it be on TV or sometimes even out in public? No. I think the message we hear is, you better follow the law. Well, no, that's Jesus said, love one another. That follows the law. And but sometimes our behavior can be anything, and including mine, can be anything but loving. So I want to ask you for what some of us might be. Okay, I'm going to get this all straightened out here. Let me ask you for what some of us might be a painful question. How genuine is your commitment to Christ? Is it primarily a Sunday morning exercise, or does it encompass your whole life, your whole being? I'm not asking to make anybody feel guilty, because I would have to do that myself. But my goal here is to help each of us discover the full joy of our commitment to Christ. Our lesson today from St. Paul's letter to the church at Rome gets right to the heart of the Christian faith. Listen closely again. Let no debt remain outstanding except the continuing debt to love one another, for whoever loves others has fulfilled the law. The commandments: you shall not commit adultery, you shall not murder, you shall not steal, you shall not covet, and whatever other commandments there are summed up in the one command: love your neighbor as yourself. And here's the biggie: love does no harm to your neighbor. Therefore, love is the fulfillment of the law. So, I want to ask again, and again, I'm pointing my fingers right back at me, and I'm asking myself this question too. Is something we all have to check in on every once in a while. How genuine is your faith? The quality of our commitment to Christ is determined by the quality of the ability to love our neighbor as we love ourselves. Several years ago, best-selling author and pastor Max Lucado, I got several of his books. He told about an occasional visitor that came to his church in San Antonio. And it was, you may remember years ago, a former all-star professional basketball player, David Robinson. David's about 7 foot tall, big dude, and obviously created a stir when he came in to the church. And they had two different services. He would come to the early church. And so in the second service, one particular Sunday, when Robinson had been in attendance for the early service, Lucado was standing to do the announcements, and when something happened that he said never happened before or since. Lucado described a scene like this. He said a homeless person came into the worship service, walked in the back of the auditorium, came down the center aisle with his backpack, ratty jeans, torn t-shirt, unshaven face, and a distinct odor. And he walked down the front of the aisle and he sat down. And Lucado writes, "The contrast struck me. When David Robinson walked in, everyone immediately swarmed around him. People wanted to touch him and be close to him. However, I'm sad that nobody jumped up to sit next to the homeless man after two or three awkward minutes during which I was trying to act like nothing was happening." Cato continues, "One of the elders got up from his seat and he sat by the man and he touched the man." He touched the man. And Lucado says, "I was struck by that." I mean, wouldn't you be? I would be too. We're struck by that. The message that Max Lucado says, "The message I received in my heart that morning was, which of these men do you think touched Jesus? If you want to touch Jesus, whom do you touch?" Well, Jesus says in Matthew 25, whatever you've done for the least of these, my brothers and sisters, you've done unto me. In other words, at least one elder in that great congregation understood what Christian faith is all about. It's about love. It's about love. It's loving those who are hurting. It's loving those who are in need, those who are lonely, those who need help, those who need hope. And we, one time or another in our lives, and maybe many times, fall into some of those categories. In 1989, Mother Teresa visited Phoenix, Arizona to open a home for the destitute. And during her visit, she was interviewed by KTAR, one of the biggest radio stations in that area, in Phoenix. And in a private conversation, the announcer asked Mother Teresa if there's anything he could do for her. And he was expecting a request for, like, I don't know, a contribution or media help or something monetarily. And instead, she said, "Yes, there is something. Find somebody nobody else loves and love them." That was it. No, find somebody else nobody else loves and love them. How genuine is our faith by this standard? Listen again to these important words. "Let no debt remain outstanding except the continuing debt to love one another, for whoever loves others has fulfilled the law, the commandments. You should not commit adultery. You should not murder. You should not steal. You should not covet." Whatever other command there may be are summed up in the one command: love your neighbor as yourself. Love does no harm. That's the test. That's the measure. That's the measuring stick. Harm. No harm. Love does no harm to another. Therefore, love is the fulfillment of the law. So again, did we catch that? Love is what it's all about. It's the fulfillment of all the commands. It's the quality of our commitment to Christ is determined by our ability to love our neighbor as ourself. And that's what St. Paul meant when he wrote in 1 Corinthians. And we use this I've preached this at a lot of weddings and at least one or two funerals. If I speak in the tongues of men or angels but do not have love, I'm only a resounding gong and a clanging cymbal. But if I have the gift of prophecy and I can fathom all mysteries and all knowledge, and I have a faith that can move mountains, but I do not have love, I am nothing. I am nothing. If I give all my possessions to the poor and give over my body to hardship that I may boast, but do not have love, I have nothing. That is to say that the quality of discipleship is determined by how surely our love for others reflects God's love toward us. We love because God first loved us. All love comes from God. Now we stand in awe of God's power, and we see it displayed in the grandeur of the stars in the sky and the beauty of the nature, right? By the way, do you know how many stars there are in the sky? Yes, someone did count them. Well, okay, in October of 2016, deep field images from the Hubble telescope suggested that there are about 200 billion trillion stars in the universe. Doesn't that blow your mind? I mean, 200 billion trillion stars, and the Lord God created them all. Every one of it. It's impossible to exaggerate God's power. A famous story about a golfer. I remember this guy, Lee Trevino. Anybody remember Lee Trevino? And yeah, Ben? Okay, this is a golf story, Ben, just so you know. Okay. But Lee Trevino, he was playing a PGA tournament, and you may have heard this, I don't know, but lightning struck a tree very near to where he was standing, and someone asked him what he thought when lightning struck the tree, and he said, "I just learned that if God wants to play through, I better let him." Isn't that right, Ben? Yeah, gotcha. That's the truth. No thinking person denies God's power. But even greater than God's power is God's love. And all of God's love is poured out to us and in us. And God's love is without equal. God holds nothing back. God's love is all-encompassing, eternal, beyond comprehension. You may have heard of C.S. Lewis, the Four Loves book. He wrote of two kinds of love. Need love, that's need love. And gift love. Need love is the most common kind of love in our world today. It's the kind of love a child for their parent or parent for child. It's need love. The infant is totally dependent on the parent or other member for survival, and therefore he or she learns to love in order to survive. Examples of need love are everywhere. A humorous example appeared in the personal section of Indiana Evening Gazette back in 1957. It read like this: "Bachelor with 40 acres of excellent land would like to make the acquaintance of a lady with a tractor." Yeah. That's need-based love. That's need-based relationship. Here's an even more honest ad from 1894 of the Davenport Tribune. "A lady, young, pretty, bright, and poor, desires to make acquaintance of a man with the opposite qualities." Let's see, what qualities are opposite from young, pretty, bright, and poor? Best wishes to that pretty, bright, but poor young woman, but that's need love, right? Example of gift love would be, that C.S. Lewis talked about, would be the love that moves a person to work a plan and save for the future of his or her family, a future in which he or she could never share. It's gift love. Gift love is entirely, God's love is entirely gift love. The outstanding examples of Christ is love on the cross in which Christ died for us. God so loved the world that he gave his only son. The Bible tells us God is love. We love because God first loved us. That's in 1 John. There goes to say that those who love God know best to gift love others. Lutheran pastor Edward Marquardt gives us a beautiful example of gift love. He says that one day he went to see one of the oldest member of his church, Al Lundy. Not Bundy, Lundy. Okay, Al Lundy, who later died in his early 90s. Al was in his 80s when this scene took place. Al was over at the retirement center, and his wife, Cora, who was suffering from Alzheimer's, Al would come to the retirement center every day with a bowl of ice cream to give his wife of many decades. By the time Al drove from his home to the retirement center, the ice cream would be melted. And Marquardt watched Al take the melted ice cream on a spoon and feed Cora as if she were a newborn baby. A newborn baby bird, even. As he put the melted ice cream into her mouth and patted her on the cheek, Marquardt said that he saw for the sure, certain sign, the genuine love of God between a man and a woman. He knew that that love was true. And he knew that that quality of love was from God. Purest kind of love, which cannot be reciprocated, and God's love is that kind of love. We don't do it so we get something back. We do it because God loved us, and he didn't ask for anything back except our life. But it's not the reciprocal kind of thing. There's nothing that we can do for God, okay? God has need of nothing in the world. He who flung the 200 billion trillion stars in the sky has no need of anything the world can offer. The only way we can gift love God is to pass God's love to a neighbor.
Richard Rohr, the Franciscan social activist and preacher, tells about a prayer he heard following one of his sermons when he was preaching in Africa. He said, an old man prayed, Lord, let us never move into stone houses. Rohr had no idea what this prayer meant. Afterward, when he was asked the old man why he prayed the way he did, the old man said, you know Africa. You've seen our country. People here live in huts. And the huts have no doors. And that's why your family is my family and my family is your family. But as soon as you move into a stone house, you have a door. On the door, you put a lock. And behind your door, you begin to accumulate more and more things. And then you have to spend the rest of your life protecting all that you have acquired. Now, there's lessons in here about love for one's neighbor that we can learn from people in so-called underdeveloped countries. There are lessons we can learn from those that have the least in our own land. Many years ago, Parade magazine carried a story of a nun who ministered to the prisoners at La Mesa Penitentiary in Tijuana, Mexico. At that time, penitentiary had a ceremony for introducing new inmates to the prison environment. And the ceremony was called grito, and the Spanish word for grito is scream. It's the Spanish word for scream, grito. So guards and police officers and officials lined the entrance and the walls to the prison cells, and the new inmate then walks between these lines. And he must repeatedly shout his name and crime and then the length of the prison sentence and any aliases that he might have. Before the grito, Sister Atonia takes each new inmate aside and she reassures them with these words. Don't be frightened or embarrassed. The Lord was a prisoner just as you are a prisoner. You have something in common. Remember that when you go through the grito. One former inmate, when recalling this moment, said, I'm not a religious man. I'd spent 2 years in another prison before being transferred to La Mesa and had turned off all of my feelings. I had turned off the rest of the world, cut them off. But when she spoke, she said, Mister, she's the most warm, caring person to walk the face of the earth. This forever changed his life. Her love changed the life of all the prisoners. She demonstrated the grace-filled gift love of God to these inmates in such a way that it changed their very lives. So I ask once again, how genuine is your faith? Or should I ask, how genuine is your love for others? The quality of our discipleship is determined by the quality of our love for God and neighbor. The quality of our discipleship is determined by how surely our love for others reflects God's love toward us. God is all-powerful and loving. The only way we can gift love is to pass God's love to our neighbor. Let no debt remain outstanding except the continuing debt to love one another, for whoever loves others has fulfilled the law. Thanks be to God for his words to us today. Amen. love fulfills all the commandments. It's also what causes us to live a moral life. The moral life doesn't lead to love. Love leads to the moral life. So it's time for our joys and concerns. We're doing joys a little differently starting today. If you notice when you come in outside, when you come in the entryway, there is a thing. It's a joy board, right? And over to the right of that, there is some pins, P-I-N-S, and pens, P-E-N-S. And there's also some sticky notes and paper and things that you can put up there. And this is designed so when you come to church, if you've got something that you want to share, a joy, maybe you have a new grandchild and you put a picture up there or whatever the case. And so we're going to share that joy. When we pray like this, when we say joy, what we're going to do at that point is like just give if I say the word testimony, that sounds like a sermon. No, it is two or three words to say, God has blessed me so much this week because this happened. And so that's how we're going to, but the main focus for our joys will be out there on the board, and then we can talk about those among each other and share our joy with each other in church. So we're going to have our time of concerns now, too, and mainly we're just going to take concerns right now. So I begin by giving you one of both. There is joy in the sense that, many of you maybe saw my son Ezra last week, and he was fine when he was in church, but he was not fine. And there is some things that happened, and I'll go into that. If you want to ask me, I'll go into detail. But essentially, Sunday night, he has some mental health issues, temporary mental health issues, acute, if you will, that caused him to be very angry and combative and whatnot. And so eventually, it all led to a voluntary hold. In a hospital in Rolla, he was sent to St. Charles, where he is now. Talked to him last night. His mom talked to him. He's been there since Monday. He is better than he was before all this happened back in July. And so we give God thanks, and it's just an ongoing thing, and I think it's going to get better as we go along. But it's an answer to prayer. I've been praying. I've asked everybody else to pray. Thank you for that, and continue to pray for Ezra. What are some other prayers that we want to lift up today for someone on our behalf or whatever you may have? Concerns. Yes, Becky? Absolutely. Thank you for that. Becky, Vicki Durham's family, Vicki, you know, passed away earlier and had a service for her yesterday, and we have food downstairs left over from all of that. And we're going to ask you to, if you'd like, Ramona and some of them are going to go down there here in a minute, and they're going to heat everything up, and they're going to put some food out if you'd like to have some lunch, because there's plenty of food down there. Sierra? Sierra's mom. We pray for her. Richard? Okay. Okay. Any others? Oh, yes, Randall. Sharon and Sharla. Okay, for Randall's sister. And then, Okay, so prayers for Lawrence and Ruby, who are not with us this morning. We know that time to time, Lawrence has some breathing difficulties and things, and so we want to lift them up, and we want to say hi to them, because I'm sure they're watching on Facebook this morning, and we're glad to have you among us. Was there any others? Thought I saw a hand. Okay. All right, so what we're going to do for our silent prayer time, notice we have these rails up here. As I call us to silent prayer, I invite you, if you would like to, come, anyone that wants to come to the altar. And sometimes we feel closer to God that way. If you want to come and kneel at the altar, or if you're not able to do that, if you want to sit on the front row, and I'll know that that's what you're doing for prayer. But that's how we'll begin our silent prayer. The altar is open to you. So let's begin this time of silent prayer, and let's do that now as we listen to the still small voice of God. Lord, we're all dealing with something. Lord, a light in the midst of darkness and fear, or whatever we're grappling, struggling with, you call us to be a community of peace, of love, and in hope. And you remind us of the blessings that we have and the opportunities to share those blessings with others. And we pray and we thank you for all of these things and for your constant presence with us. Today, as a community seeking peace and healing, we offer the names of the loved ones who are struggling with illness and with loss and with feelings of alienation and fear. And we name the ones dear to us aloud in this congregation that we may enter a prayer for these folks seeking your healing and your hope in their lives. We lift up the concerns of this community of faith. We also offer messages of love and rejoicing as we offer prayers of thanksgiving and joy in our community of faith. Lord, we thank you for your healing mercies, for your sustaining love for us. We are confident in your abiding presence with us. Help us to be faithful to you in all times and in all places. Give us the grace to accept the forgiveness that you have offered to each of us. For it is in Jesus' name that we offer this prayer, and we pray as God, through Jesus, taught us to pray. Our Father, which art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, and thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen.
The ushers would come forward, please.
Please stand for an doxology. God, giver of all gifts, God of light, God of glory, we give you thanks for these gifts that you have given us and blessed us with. May we use these gifts to bless others and to bring your light into this dark world. In Christ we pray and give thanks. Amen.
Please remain standing for our sending hymn, Freely, Freely. That's number 389 in your hymnal.
So we give God thanks. We give God thanks for his love that is shown in others. We give God thanks for the life of Vicki Durham, who was part of our church family for many years. And we lift up her family, Chris and all, and Raylene. Lord, just be with them and comfort them in this hour. We are so thankful, Lord, that we could have a dinner for them yesterday. We're thankful we could do that. Please know that there's a lot of leftovers, good stuff. There's some roast beef down there. There's some cordon bleu. That's what I call it, cordon bleu. But there is green beans and some salad, different things. So please come on down if you'd like to have lunch. Everyone's invited. You didn't have to bring anything. It's all good. So go in peace, and may the love of Christ be shed abroad in your hearts now and forever. Amen.